Hello friends, welcome to the video lecture. My name is Dharmavir Marchino and I'm working as faculty and assistant director training at IIBF. Today's session is on functions of regulation or supervision of banking in India and recent trends in banking. In the beginning, we'll discuss about functions of banks. The main functions of banks are borrowing and raising money, lending money, dealing in bills of exchange and other negotiable instruments, dealing in letters of credit, traveler's check, dealing in bullion, dealing in foreign exchange, dealing in shares, debentures, etc., doing portfolio business, holding documents in safe custody, and providing safe deposit vaults. Now, for any bank, they have to give service to their customers in terms of depositing their money into banks. And through this, only banks raise money from the market. The banks can offer savings banks accounts or current account, where customers or small business people can deposit their money. On these deposited money, the bank gives interest to the customers. Now, the same money which has been deposited by the customers needs to be given as loans or advances into the market. That is called lending of money. Now, why this is required, lending of money? It is required because the banks need to give money in terms of interest to the depositors for their money. So how do they get that money? They get that money because they charge interest on the money what they give as loans and advances into the market. Plus, the banks also have some operational costs involved in running the banks. So all these interest given on deposits and the operational cost is recovered from the interest charge on the money which has been given as advances or loans. So these are two main functions of banks. And the survival of bank is dependent on these two main functions. If these two main functions are robust for any bank, the chances of bank surviving in the market is very high and it can take on any competition in the market. Apart from these two main functions, bank also deals in bills of exchange and other negotiable instruments. Now, what is bill of exchange? Bill of exchange is normally prepared by the creditor who gives money to the debtor, and it has to be accepted by the debtor. The bill of exchange says that a certain amount of money has to be paid on certain date by the debtor to the creditor, or you can say the importer to the exporter. How it is different from promissory note, which is also one of the negotiable instruments? A promissory note is signed by the debtor saying that I will give this much of amount on this date to the creditor. Whereas the bills of exchange is actually prepared by the creditor, but it has to be accepted by the debtor to be valid. Check is another example of negotiable instrument. So banks deals with all kinds of negotiable instruments, which includes bills of exchange, promissory note, and checks. Then banks also deals in letters of credit. Letters of credits are issued on behalf of the importer, which states that after the goods are received by the importer, the bank takes the guarantee of paying the money to the exporter. So the letter of credit is issued in on behalf of the importer to the exporter, taking the guarantee of payment of the goods exported by the exporter to the importer. And as soon as the goods reaches the importer and the documents are submitted, the bank pays to the exporter on behalf of the importer. And the letters of credit is issued on behalf of the importer by taking into account the payment capacity of the importer, who is also the customer of the bank. Then banks also issue traveler's checks, because it is difficult to carry foreign exchange to the foreign country when you are traveling to foreign countries. So people can take traveler's checks from banks and they can take it to the foreign country and get it in cash. Then banks also deals in bullion. RBI gives, or you can say RBI nominates some banks to import bullion, which is gold in the form of bricks or biscuit, to our country, and that bullion is then sold by banks to the customers. These bullion are normally sold to the jewelers, who use these bullions to prepare or manufacture jewelries. Now banks can give bullion as a loan also to the jewelers, and after the jewelries are manufactured and it is sold, then the repayment of the value of bullion is, you can say it starts, and by this the jewelers pay it back to the banks. The banks also deal in foreign exchange. Then banks also give loans against shares and debentures. Banks are also involved in the managing the portfolio, or you can say investment or wealth management of their customers, who may be high net worth individuals also. So banks advise their customers how to invest their money into more profitable areas where they can get more returns on their investment. Then banks also have got a function of keeping the documents of their customers in safe custody. And banks also provide safe deposit vaults where the customers can keep their valuables and other important documents also. So these are the main functions of the banks. And with these functions, banks get their income in the form of interest or fee what they charge from the customers on different services provided to the customers. Now, if we classify the functions of banks under traditional functions, then as discussed before, we can say that the main function, traditional function of bank, is to accept deposit. And the advantage of accepting deposits from customers is that these are safe for the customers, and the customers have got the option of liquidity of money. That means anytime if they want money from the bank, they can get it, they can withdraw it from the bank, and the customers also get income on the deposit in terms of interest what they get on the money they have deposited in the bank. Banks also provide periodical statement of transactions and statements of account to the depositors. In public sector banks, normally we have got passbooks for the bank account, and private sector banks normally give monthly statement and annual statement to the customers. But in private sector banks also, customers have got the option of asking for the passbook. If the customer insists on the passbook for their account, then private sector banks also need to provide the passbook to the customers. Now, banks also have got a function of issuing checkbooks to the customers of current account and savings bank account, through which the customers can withdraw the money from their account from the bank. Then the another traditional function of bank is loan and advances. As discussed before, banks have to pay interest on the deposit at agreed rates of interest. In addition, they have to meet their operational expenses. Therefore, banks have to invest or lend the money what they have got through deposits and earn interest on that, so that they can pay the interest to the customers on their deposits and also cover the operational expenses of the banks. Now, the main issue which comes with the loans and advances for the bank is the NPAs. Nowadays, the non-performing assets of banks is increasing, and this has become the main reason for banks to collapse or fail. So there need to be a good mechanism for recovery of overdues from the customers, so that all the accounts remain performing assets and they do not become non-performing assets. Because if the non-performing assets increases, then the profitability of bank goes down. So this is the main issue in terms of loans and advances is concerned, and banks need to check the issue of non-performing assets for their organization. The other traditional function for bank is the remittance services. The customers have to make payment for purchases in the place of their business or in the place of business of the vendor or seller. Now, this requires for the movement of money from one place to another place. But it may not be possible for the buyers to move from place to place for making payments. And it is also not advisable to carry a large sum of money from place to place to pay to the sellers. So the bank comes into the picture, and they, on behalf of the buyers, they transfer or remit the money to the sellers. And in this way, the buyers are able to pay the buying cost to the sellers without any effort. So remittance is one of the important traditional functions of banks, and it is very useful for the buyers as well as for the sellers. Now, there are also other miscellaneous services provided by the banks, which we can call other functions of the bank. As discussed earlier, these services include safe deposit lockers, safe custody of valuables, issuance of traveler's checks, letter of credit and guarantees, and collection of outstation checks, bills and hundis. Now, we have already discussed letters of credit, but about guarantees, we can say that guarantees are actually issued by banks on behalf of the person who has taken a task to perform. And in case of the non-performance of that task, the bank is liable to pay the damages with whom the person who has taken the task got into the agreement. If the person is not able to fulfill the task on time, or if the task is not up to the mark in terms of quality. So it is a guarantee from the bank that the person who has taken the responsibility of performing the task will perform it on time and with quality. If he doesn't perform on time or with quality, then on behalf of the performer, the bank will pay to the beneficiary. Now, as far as other functions of banks is concerned, banks also furnish opinion reports of their customers. Sometimes, when it is asked from the legal authority of the country, then banks furnish the details about the customers. Banks also sometimes works as the agency service for government business, like managing the cash management, account management, on behalf of government. Sometimes they also issue letters of credit. So banks also sometimes work as agent for the government businesses. Sometimes banks also work as correspondent banks. They also work as, or they also take the trusteeship for managing the state of some people, or if it is by law, by the court assigned to the banks. And sometimes they also discharge the duty of executors if asked by the court of law to perform. On all these miscellaneous services, banks charge a commission or fee, and that goes to the income of the bank, and it is shown as the non-interest income of the bank, which helps in improving the profit margin of the banks. Then nowadays, since we are becoming digital, the electronic banking is a very important aspect of functions of banking. The electronic banking has opened new areas in service delivery by adopting new banking channels like phone banking, internet banking, credit card, debit card, and ATM, that is automated teller machines. So banks provide different kind of electronic banking services to the customers in terms of phone banking, internet banking, credit card offering, debit card offering, and ATMs. So nowadays, the banking is not as it was in the past. Now we have moved from the traditional brick and mortar branch banking to electronic banking in terms of the banking channels which we have discussed: phone banking, internet banking, debit card, credit card, automated teller machines, etc. Now we'll discuss about the supervision or regulation of banks in India. The banks are regulated or supervised through Banking Regulation Act of 1949. The Banking Regulation Act 1949 says that it's an anchor law of Indian banking, and it gives all the rules from commencement of business of bank till the winding up of the banks. The definition of banking is defined in the Section 5B of the BR Act 1949, and banking is defined as the acceptance of deposits of money from the public for the purpose of lending or investment. Such deposits may be repayable or on demand or otherwise, and withdrawable by check, draft, order, or otherwise. Then the Section 6(1) of BR Act also says about other businesses which are permitted for banks to perform. BR Act also empowers RBI in discharging its role as central bank and as the regulatory authority of the banking sector of the country. Now, the section 22-23 of the BR Act regulates banks and branch licensing. So in section 22-23, the rules are given how the banks will be regulated and how the branch licensing will be given. The section 11 of the same act stipulates the minimum capital requirement for the bank. Section 21 deals with the direction for advances, and that also gives idea about the purpose of advance, how much margin will be taken for advance, what will be the interest rate, and maximum amount or exposure limit of the advances. Then section 35 of BR Act tells about directions for deposits and other businesses. Section 45 ZA/ZB and ZC tells you about nomination facilities. Section 20 of the BR Act gives a restriction on certain advances. And section 10A of the BR Act stipulates prerequisites for directors. Now, if you sum up the BR Act, it is for regulating business of banking companies, control over management of banks, suspension and winding up of banking business, and penalties for breach or violation of this act. Now we'll move towards recent trends in banking. Now the banking has moved towards electronic payment services. So the checks are sent in the truncated format wherein the image of the check is sent across for clearance. Then we also have got the concept of e-check, wherein the check is same as the physical check, but it is in the electronic form and digitally signed. Then we have got real-time gross settlement, that is called RTGS, where you can send the money above 2 lakhs and within 2 hours, the money will be credited in the account of the beneficiary. Then we also have got electronic fund transfer. If somebody wants to transfer their money from their account to some other account, or if they have the cash, they can go to the bank, give the cash to the bank, and ask the bank to transfer that cash to a particular account through electronic fund transfer. NEFT is done in batches, and there is no minimum and maximum amount fixed for NEFT. Previously, we had 11 batches of NEFT per hour, one batch, and the timing for NEFT was from 8 in the morning to 7 in the evening. Now it has been increased by 11 more numbers. So previously it was 12, now it is 11. So every half an hour the NEFT is done in batches. So total batches are 23 for NEFT as of now. Then we have got electronic clearance services, where the retail payment system that can be used to make bulk payments or receipts of a similar nature, especially where each individual payment is of repetitive nature and of relatively small amount. So people, the customers can use this ECS service where if suppose they have to pay a fixed amount on a fixed interval, so banks can transfer their money on their behalf, and that money is transferred for many customers together at a time in bulk. So the ECS can be used for payments as well as receipts in bulk for the customers. Then we have got the automated teller machine, that is ATM, for the customers for withdrawing cash from the bank. Then we also have got the recent trends in banking in the form of point of sale terminal wherein the point of sale terminal is a computer terminal that is linked online to the computerized customer information files in a bank and magnetically encoded plastic transaction card that identifies the customer to the computer. During a transaction, the customer's account is debited and the retailer's account is credited by the computer for the amount of purchase. So, for example, if you go to a mall to buy something, that mall will have the point of sale terminal, and your card, whether it's a credit card or debit card, will be swiped in that machine if you buy something, and that machine is connected with the database of bank, and your money will be debited directly from the bank and will be credited in the account of the retailer from where you have bought the things. So this is how the point of sale terminal works. Then we have got telebanking also in current days, where customers have got the facility to get their banking services done by talking to the bank executives on phone. They can give instructions to the bank executives on phone and get their work done. Maybe issuing of the demand draft or transfer of money or withdrawal of money. It can be done through telebanking also. Then in the recent trend, we also have got electronic data interchange, which is called EDI. Electronic data interchange is the electronic exchange of business documents like purchase order, invoices, shipping notices, receiving advices, etc., in a standard computer processed, universally accepted format between trading partners. EDI can also be used to transmit financial information and payment in electronic form. So electronic data interchange is a electronic exchange of business documents from one person to another person or from one company to another company. And these documents may be purchase order, invoices, shipping notices, and it is in a standard form and it is processed by computer and then it is transferred and it is mutually accepted by the trading partners. So the format in which these documents are transferred has to be mutually or universally accepted by the partners who are involved in this transaction. So these were the recent trends in banking sector. Now the major challenge which is being faced by banks in today's world is to cope up with the competition which they are having and to improve the balance sheet in terms of profitability of the bank. And one more major challenge which we have discussed earlier also is that the increase in the non-performing assets of the bank, which is reducing the profit margin of the banks. So by this, now we have come to know about the functions of banks, how the banks are regulated, and what are the new trends in the banking sector, and what are the challenges faced by banks. So I hope you must have enjoyed the session. Thank you very much. And you can improve your knowledge by referring to different banking magazines, newspapers, and websites of RBI and other banks. So with this, we will end today's session. Thank you very much. All the best.